A match over 18 holes between one of the greatest players in the game today, winner of over 30 international opens, and veteran Canada Cup representative, Roberto De Vicenzo of Buenos Aires, Argentina, and the brilliant young star of the PGA circuit, who numbers the coveted British Open Championship among his many other titles, Ryder Cup star Tony Lema of San Leandro, California. To analyze today's match, the legendary Gene Sarazen, winner of every major title in professional golf. I'm George Rogers on the scene here in Athens, and this is Shell's Wonderful World of Golf, a series of international matches played on the world's most famous golf courses. This week, the Glyfada Golf Club, Athens, Greece. Here was the beginning. On this rock thrusting upward from the Grecian plain, a seed took root and grew into a way of life destined to outlast even the mighty stones of the temples. This is the Acropolis, crowned by what has been called man's most nearly perfect architectural achievement, the Parthenon. Socrates walked here, and Plato, and Aristotle. Here they formed and expounded the ideas that have guided man ever since in his search for the perfect world. Pericles and Demosthenes walked here and helped lead man to the dignity of self-government, for here was fashioned the world's first democracy. Aeschylus, Sophocles, and Aristophanes walked here and gave man's imagination a new breadth, a new dimension in this, the world's first formal theater. Today, the ancient splendor of the Acropolis still dominates the modern city that has grown up around it. For Athens is a city that honors the past by making it part of the present. And the Greek ideal of beauty that distinguished the old finds its true reflection in the new. In today's sidewalk cafes, the people meet and talk over their problems and argue the solutions, just as they did centuries ago in the marketplace. Even in sports, the continuity with the past is unbroken. Every 2 years, the world's greatest distance runners retrace the path of the ancient Greek warrior who carried the news of victory over the Persians from the village of Marathon to the waiting citizens of Athens in 490 BC. And the winner of this modern marathon adds another chapter to the long and glorious sports history of Greece, the land that gave the world the Olympic Games. But today, the Athenian countryside is the setting for another game with a long and glorious tradition. And here's a man who helped build that tradition, Gene Sarazen.
Believe me, golfers in America have no idea of the treat that's in store for them when they visit Athens, Greece. You have to pinch yourself to realize that you're playing in a foreign country and not along the scenic coast of Santa Barbara, California. This course, which is only 3 years old, was cut out of a forest of 500-year-old pine. And if you've ever seen a place where you have to be straight off the tee, this is it. The bunkering is first rate because it sets off the greens in such a way that you have a target for every shot. The greens are contoured so that every putt is a challenge. They're planted in bent grass and they putt true. But it pays you to take a little time to study the line. I don't think you'll find a more enjoyable golf course in all of Europe, both scenically and to play. So if you're a golfer, bring your golf clubs when you come to Greece, or you'll have missed one of the best parts of your trip.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, in addition to the very fine description of the course which Gene just gave, we might tack on one thing. The Glyfada Golf Club is located right on the immediate periphery of the Athens International Airport. So throughout the match today, you're going to hear the big jet planes landing and taking off literally right over these fairways. The players have found that they're not bothered at all after a few holes in practice, and I'm sure it won't bother you either. Tony and Roberto, we'd like to remind you and everybody in the audience now that this is 18 holes stroke play competition, for a total purse of $10,000 in prize money, with $7,000 going to the winner and $3,000 to the loser. Of course, should you finish dead even, $5,000 apiece. And here in Greece, golf is played under the rules of the Royal and Ancient Golf Club of St. Andrews, Scotland.
Well, since we're playing the RNA rules, have you decided what type of ball you're going to play, what size, Roberto?
Well, Gene, I think I could play the small ball.
How about you, Tony?
I'm going for a big one, Gene, and I'd go for a bigger one if I could find it.
Well, I think we're about ready, so I'll toss the coin. Call it, heads or tails?
Heads, I shoot first.
See that? I'm one down already.
It looks like the tail, and Roberto has the
honor.
Good luck to you, fellas.
Thank you, George.
Play well, right? The first hole at the Glyfada Golf Club is a straightaway par 4 of 400 yards playing through a narrow corridor of trees past a fairway bunker 220 yards out on the right. The approach is to a very deep undulating green bunkered at the right front corner and encircled by trees. By the way, the length of this course just under 6,500 yards playing to a par of 72.
Well, Gene, we're set to get started here, and here's the fellow who down through the years certainly has to be regarded as one of the best players in the game.
Yes, he's probably the greatest player that came out of South America. And I want to tell you that every time you see him, he looks better. He's getting better with age. He's a powerful hitter, but he has one fault. He's always fighting a hook.
Well, Roberto started his tee shot out to the right, is drawing it in, and catches it right down in the fairway. And boy, he has hit it big. He threw it way, way past that trap at 200 yards.
Speaking of good players, here's a fellow who in the last couple of years has just become a tremendous golfer.
Yes, I was just asking him about his game, and he was telling me that he's not holding those 10-footers like he used to. But this should be a terrific match with these two fellas, both powerful hitters. And this fellow has a little fault, too. He fights a hook.
Well, most good players do at one time or another in their career. Tony didn't hook that. As a matter of fact, if anything, he hit it the other way, a little bit from left to right. He could be somewhere in the vicinity of that bunker down there. Tony Lema pushed his opening tee shot out to the right, carried the bunker, wound up maybe 245 yards or so from the tee in the late rough in among the trees, and he really has quite an easy routine shot to play here because he has plenty of room to get the ball up. Tony is going to hit an 8-iron. Tony pulled it way left. Way left. Caught the fairway and then bounced off into the rough, so he's going to miss the very first green. You cannot hit your opening tee shot much better than Roberto De Vicenzo hit his here in the first hole. Better than 280 with that small ball right in the middle of the fairway. And he has a wedge shot of, oh, perhaps a little bit better than 100 yards to the green. And Roberto has pulled his and pulled it well to the left, missed the green, hit in the fringe, and trickled onto the edge of the green at the rear left corner of the putting surface. Tony Lema in early trouble here in the match, 120-odd feet from the hole in light rough, playing off hard, baked-out dirt with trees directly in his line. He cannot wedge the ball because he'll have too much height. He has what looks like a 6 or 7 iron trying to bump it on the green into the hill. Hit that low driving shot and is going to trickle it down very close to the pin. What a shot! Tony Lehman is going to mark his ball, which is maybe 3 or 3.5 feet from the cup, and Gene Roberto's left himself close to a 30-footer.
Yeah, he doesn't have too hard a putt to lay dead, though. But you know, Lima certainly was lucky off that tee shot and that second shot.
Referee Hector Thompson looking on here. He's the pro at Glyfada, former Walker Cup. As a matter of fact, in 1938, he played on the only British Walker Cup team ever to beat the U.S. amateurs. Looks pretty good for speed.
There's a pretty good way to start. Now, you notice that he left the flag in unattended. Under the rules of the RNA, you can do that. There's no penalty for hitting that unattended flag stick, and you kind of use that as a backstop, Gene.
Yes, they like that, the pros do.
Roberto started with a birdie on the first hole. Tony Lima this short about to save his par.
I've seen that rule work in reverse, though. That ball could have hit sideways and been left out of the hole.
Well, Tony made himself a pretty good four. Gene, I wanted to ask you, on the Tony's second shot, he had an 8-iron over there from a good lie, and what looked to be a very routine, easy shot, and yet missed the green way to the left. What happened there?
He turned over on the shot. He's a little afraid, but he had a beautiful lie. I never thought he'd hit a shot like that, because usually they complain about having too much grass, but there, he just turned right over on it.
Pulled it a bit, but he got away with it.
But the third shot he played was a typical St. Andrews.
Beautiful little pitch and runner, bump shot. One hole complete, Roberto De Vicenzo, one under par, leading by one stroke. Here at the Glyfada Golf Club in Athens, Greece, on Shell's Wonderful World of Golf.
De Vicenzo continued with the honor on the 324-yard par 4 second hole. Our slow-motion camera vividly recorded the action as the powerful Argentinian unloaded another big drive of close to 300 yards, right down the middle of the fairway. Lema, on the other hand, seemed a trifle late getting the clubhead through and pushed his second tee shot in a row. It bounced off a pine tree back into the right-hand limits of the fairway, some 250 yards up. For his short approach, Tony decided on a pitching wedge. And he hit a beauty, which finished a scant 4 feet from the flag. Roberto, who had driven within 25 yards of the green, also chose a wedge. His ball narrowly missed hitting the pin, but finished a disappointing distance past the hole.
Tony Lema, who hit a beautiful high soft-falling wedge in here 4 feet from the hole, has marked his ball. De Vicenzo, a downhill right-to-left breaking putt of about 30 feet. Gene, this is one of those courses where you have mountains on one side and water on the other, so what usually happens to the break of the putt?
Well, usually it falls away from the mountain there. Now, he doesn't have any grain to buck there. Tony has the grain to go against.
Roberto pulled that putt, started it left of the hole, and it stayed left all the way.
But he hit that an awful belt.
Yeah. He's left himself maybe 2.5 feet away. Roberto rolled that one right in for his par four, and he's going to remain one under par after two holes. Tony now with a putt up about 4 feet. For birdie three to even the match. Right in the heart. Not much question about that one, was there, Gene? Huh?
No.
Tony, congratulations.
Nice.
Thanks,
three.
George. I didn't think I'd get a win there, but I'll take it.
What do you suppose happened to Roberto's shot that went way past that thing?
Well, he hit it kind of down a little too low, George. The green here slopes away from you. I threw mine up in the air kind of high, and it still ran a little. And he hit his in low, and it didn't check up, and it took off on him.
Mm-hmm. Tony, you don't have much respect for these 500-year-old pines, do you?
I've hit two of them so far, sir.
Well, I'll get straightened out, I'm sure. Two holes complete now, and our match is dead even. Both Tony and Roberto, one under par on Shell's Wonderful World of Golf.
He has never seen the Parthenon, but he is as Greek as the men who built it. His is another Greece that has nothing to do with ancient splendors or the glories of the past. His Greece is vibrant, lusty, alive. His Greece is now. This is the Greece you see when you get off the beaten track, away from the ordinary. Feast day in a mountain village, filled with sound and color, bursting with the zest, the passion, the exuberant love for life that is so much a part of Greek character. But you could miss this Greece. You could pass right by this village without hearing the music, seeing the dancing, or knowing this man. Unless, of course, you had stopped here first, at this familiar sign. This is a Shell tourist center, typical of many maintained by Shell of Greece on major highways throughout this exciting land. Here you'll find trained hostesses, skilled in many languages, whose job it is to provide you with the information and services you need to make your trip more pleasant, more enjoyable, more rewarding. The latest route information, weather reports, even special tour guides are available to you here. A pleasant snack bar where you can find rest and refreshments before you resume your journey. Even a boutique where you can buy that first souvenir of your trip. All here, courtesy of Shell. Plus that tip about feast day in the village you could have driven right by. The Parthenon? Of course you must see it. But when you go touring with Shell, you'll see much more of Greece. Or any other place you're likely to travel. For in Greece and throughout the world, this is the symbol of a group of companies joined in a common dedication to excellence. In a constant search for new products, new ideas, new ways to serve you better. On the third hole at the Glyfada Golf Club in Athens, Greece, a 526-yard par 5, both Lema, who switched to the small ball for added distance, and De Vicenzo were just off the green in two.
Gene, I would say that Lima's maybe 45 feet away and Roberto maybe about 40 or so.
Yes, Tony has a very difficult shot there. He has a putter in his hand and he's right up against the green.
He's coming uphill all the way.
About 4 feet short.
Boy, he hit that hard enough to go across the green.
The old joke goes, Gene, maybe he didn't have enough club. Roberto is trying to chip from his shoulder near the bunker with an 8-iron. Well, he failed to get it inside of Tony Lima. Little bit, I would say, about 6 feet.
Yeah, he had enough information to know he was against the grain, but he didn't take advantage of it.
Now, De Vicenzo lining up a putt of about 6 feet for a birdie four. Yeah, and missing it on the left. You see that ball swing away from the range?
Yeah, the grain.
It's a big factor here. Roberto taps in for a par five, and after three holes, he will remain one under par.
Look at the caddy looking over that grain.
Well, we repeat again, I have mountains on one side of this course, the sea on the other. And the grain will generally cause the ball to break away from the mountains and toward the sea in the direction in which the grass grows.
Here's a type of putt that you cannot baby. You have to hit the back of the hole.
And he does.
So three holes complete now here at the Glyfada Golf Club in Athens, Greece. Tony Lima is two under par and has opened up a one-stroke lead on Shell's wonderful world of golf.
Both players matched par on the 394-yard fourth hole, with Lima maintaining his one-stroke lead.
The fifth hole at 164 yards is the first of Glyfada's par threes. A medium iron is usually struck to a 100-foot deep green, which is bunkered at the right front and falls away in the opposite direction. Well, the fifth hole is playing downwind today, which is going to make it a little more difficult to judge the shot. And as Tony Lima tees up his ball, a great big jetliner is flying right down over the tee. Listen to it. Tony Lima will hit a 6-iron here. And he's starting to pull out considerably to the right, and it is going to carry right into the gallery and hit a spectator on the leg, I believe, and stopped in the fringe just about a foot off the green. Roberto De Vicenzo now is going to hit a 7-iron. And he also started it well to the right, but now it is swinging in. Hit almost exactly pin high. What a shot. Tony Lima, maybe a foot in the fringe, in the shade of a big, narrow old pine tree, maybe 25 feet from the hole. Gene, apparently Tony is going to use a putter here.
Yes, he plays that putter pretty well off the fringe. And he has the grain with him, so it's all in his favor.
Holding it, huh? Didn't miss by too much, Jim. Just a little bit on the low side as the ball swung away. I think we'll usual stance not to step in Roberto's line, and puts her right in there to make three and continue at two under.
That was a beautiful shot Roberto hit on that tee there.
Walked up on the green, they gave him a nice round of applause, and he says, I missed this shot too much on the left. Tony, we're very happy to pass along the information that the spectator who was struck was not hurt, just caught on the calf of the leg open.
Thank you, George. I spoke with us. It had a good break there then.
Yes, indeed. Where's Roberto with a putt of 4 feet to join you at 200 if he can get it in?
Good putt.
Mm-hmm. Got it right in there, and there's a big smile.
Good putter, huh?
Well, looking very long to me.
That was a fine shot that you hit in here from the tee, Roberto.
Thank you. I hit an easy 7-iron.
Uh-huh.
I catch a half sharp and hit it. Really very lucky to put the ball so close.
Well, you've even the match now. 5 holes complete. We have a brand new ball game. Both players 2 under par on Shell's Wonderful World of Golf. On the next couple of holes, DeVincenzo's driver got him in trouble. On the 434-yard par 4 sixth, his hook tee shot finished uncomfortably close to an out-of-bounds fence.
Roberto, you hit that one about 270 yards, but a couple of more feet and you'd have been across the road there, out of bounds.
Well, Jim, I'm being sorry, but I know I'd be the artist like you.
Tell me, how are you going to play this shot off that hard ground there with the trees in front of you and everything?
Well, Jim, I don't know. I'd be in trouble here. I want to see you hit the shot and I talk to you.
No, you play the shot. Are you going to play it safe or are you going to go to the green?
No, I try to go to the green.
You are, huh? Well, good luck to you. We'll watch you.
Thank you. You pray for me.
Yeah.
He attempted to cut a low forearm in an effort to get close to the green. When the shot did not come off, he bogeyed, and failing to match Lima's 4, Roberto fell 1 stroke behind at 1 under par. Double dogleg par 5 of 560 yards, the likable South American made his error on the other side of the fairway, pushing his drive into a bunker 285 yards out on the right. He picked the ball so cleanly with a 3-iron that hardly a grain of sand was disturbed, and the resulting brilliant 200-yard recovery shot enabled him to scramble a 5, match Lima's par, and continue to trail by a single stroke at 1 under regulation figures. The 8th hole is a beautiful and demanding par 3 of 181 yards. The boomerang-shaped green is fairly large, but it is well trapped and has trees crowding in on the left. Both Lema and DeVincenzo hit the green with 6 irons, but neither was close to the hole. Both Roberto and Tony have left themselves pretty good putts here on number 8. Roberto a real long one, better than 40 feet. Tony maybe 26 or 27 feet. Beautiful approach, Bob.
He had that figured out right, huh?
Did he ever?
You notice that all these good golfers are great approach putters.
Well, Roberto taps that short one in for his 3, and he remains 1 under par through 8 holes.
We're looking at another great approach putter right here, Tony Lema.
Not only a great approach putter, Gene, but I don't think there's a deadlier putter in golf from 10 to 12 feet on in. He very rarely misses those clutch putts. Tony's face never changed expression. I think he was a little disappointed to leave that just inches short. He taps in for his 3, remains 2 under, and continues to lead by 1 stroke. Glyfada's front 9 concludes with an exceptionally good 394-yard par 4 dogleg to the left, protected by out-of-bounds on the same side. The elevated green sits on an exposed knoll, has a water hazard in front, a massive trap to the right, and steep fallaway on three sides.
We are in the process of rounding out the front nine here at Glyfada with Tony Lema. We got off to just a little bit of a shaky start, particularly in the driving department. Going along very steadily now, continuing at 200 par and leading by one stroke. Ideal type of shot to hit here, of course, is a controlled hook and draw from right to left out around the angle.
Tony has, however, hit it pretty much straight away, if anything, a little bit to the right. That thing kicks to the right, and if it stayed in the fairway, it didn't stay in by much. It could be in the rough.
Here's a hole, of course, just laid out for De Vicenzo's style of play. He is a natural right-to-left player. It's been so all of his golfing career. In fact, that's been his biggest problem, has been to try to fight that hook which crops into his game now and then.
Now, he started away to the right, but he's hooked it rather sharply. Let's see. Now, that's going to be all right. That ought to be just fine in the fairway. Tony Lema pushed his drive here a little bit on the ninth hole as a plane comes in for its approach to the airport. He still hit it big, though, about 265 down the right side, and with a following wind, he will hit a 9-iron. And it's going to be up all right. Hit it almost exactly pin high, but again, it kept on going, and he'll have a downhill putt coming back toward the front of the green.
Well, sir, you talk about big tee shots. With a small British ball and a following wind and a right-to-left hooking flight on the ball, De Vicenzo drove about 310 or 15 yards. Will wedge it. And he has pushed it right and short and doesn't make the green. Roberto De Vicenzo's approach here to the ninth green hit the bank and plugged, embedded itself in the mud, so he is entitled to relief. So rules referee Hector Thompson. He has lifted the ball. His caddy has cleaned it. And now Roberto will stand erect facing the hole, drop that ball over his shoulder, and should it roll more than two club lengths from where it struck the ground, he'll keep on dropping it, and eventually, I believe, will be allowed to place it by hand. You see, that went down almost to the water, so now he'll come up and drop it again. And if he does that a couple of times, he will be, as we said, entitled to replace the ball by hand without penalty. That one almost went all the way back in the water. No way he can stop it. So now I believe the referee is going to move in and rule that Roberto may replace that ball as near as possible to where it was plugged, but of course no near the hole. And he's having just a little bit of trouble getting it to stay even there. That's a very sharp bank. Now I believe he has it. And now he will walk up and take a look at his shot. Now Roberto has looked at this shot. It's maybe 45, 50 feet. He has a wedge, and he'll try to chip this one up close. And that's going to pull up a little bit soon on him. He'll have that putt to try to save a par, and I'm not at all sure he got that the way he wanted to. Well, here on the ninth green, Tony Lema finds himself with a decided advantage. He lies two. His opponent lies three. Tony with a very slippery downhill putt with the grain of close to 30 feet. Gee, that's a wonderful putt from there.
That is a great putt from there.
He just barely hit that ball.
So Tony finishes an exceptionally fine front nine, two under par, 34. Roberto, an uphill putt of 10 feet, which he must hold to save his par four and remain one under. Well, he was coming uphill against the grain, left it short. We'll make a bogey five to finish at even par. And, of course, two strokes behind. Gene, what did you think of the front nine in general?
Well, I think they did some remarkable approach putting and putting, but De Vincenzo never took advantage of his terrific driving. Like, for instance, this ninth hole here, he hit a ball 300 yards and took five on the hole.
And the same on the second hole. He hit a ball almost 300 yards and didn't get it, come up with anything. All in all, I think they scored very well. You know, that is a pretty tough nine holes. The fairways are very narrow.
Very easy to put it off the fairway, and of course you get penalized. Tony, it looked like you barely touched that ball from the back of the green.
That one was pretty fast there, George. I was coming down green.
Mm-hmm. How do you feel about your front nine in general?
Well, I feel like I just got out of jail the way I've been driving the ball.
Roberto, I didn't think you'd leave that one short.
Well, I tried to not leave short, but I think I scared a little bit to hit. It's very heavy from this way.
Grain is very definitely a factor, isn't it?
A lot of it on this particular green.
Yeah.
Well, I would think 34, 36 is pretty good scoring on that nine.
Well, it's the best we're going to be able to do.
Can't start again. Back nine remains, Gene. What do you say we get started?
Well, let's go. You follow me. I'll take you over there.
Tony Lima continued with the honor on the 10th hole at the Glyfada Golf Club in Athens, Greece, a 490-yard par 5 dogleg to the right, playing down a narrow aisle of trees. The slow-motion camera captured the tall Californian's whiplash uncoiling as he drove better than 260 yards dead center fairway. De Vicenzo, on the other hand, seemed to let his right hand overpower his left and hooked badly into the adjacent 18th fairway. Although he had driven an equal distance off the tee, Roberto was away due to the angle of the dogleg. He aimed a 3-iron over the solid wall of trees and smashed a desperate shot in the direction of the blind green, hoping to get his ball somewhere close to the putting surface. By contrast, Lima had a completely open shot and tried to get home in two with a 4-wood. He pulled the ball well to the left and watched it head toward trees and gallery. It struck a small building to the left of the green and, as though drawn on a string, reversed its direction and rolled right back to the corner of the putting surface. Roberto's ball had come to rest near the same building his opponent had just struck. From better than 100 feet, he hit a low, running chip with a 9-iron, but finished well past the pin. Tony addressed a chip shot of some 60 feet with a 6-iron. He hit it stiff and subsequently tapped in for a birdie 4 to slip to 3 under par. De Vicenzo would now have to hole a 16-footer or lose another stroke to his opponent. He went for it boldly but missed by a fraction of an inch on the left. So despite the fact that the South American would be able to scramble a hard-earned 5, his even par effort still found him trailing by 3 strokes. The 11th is a rather short par 4 of 350 yards, and a good player may decide to cut the dogleg right by driving over that bunker 175 yards out. The approach must carry a slight depression in the fairway as it plays to a banked green, which is trapped at the right front corner.
Well, here on the 11th tee, it would appear to me that Lima may have gone back to the big ball. It's kind of a short hole. If you hit it just straight over that dogleg, you can almost drive the green.
And he's cut it. He's hit it from left to right. But I believe he hit it far enough to avoid the trees on that side, and he may very well be all right.
Now, De Vicenzo, and you can kind of look at Roberto's face and figure out the thought processes for yourself. He has now dropped 3 strokes behind. And, of course, somewhere along the line here has to begin to make a move.
He hit it way, way right, high and far. That would be green high, but way to the right of the fairway.
Well, Tony Lima faded his drive a little bit here on the 11th. Caught a tree, but nonetheless got it down the fairway about 270. He now has a big pine parsley in his line. He's going to choke way down on a 7-iron and try to play a little left to right cut shot around the trees. Swing outside in with an open face. And he cut it low. Takes a bounce and he'll run around the green. Got around the right front corner, but he's not happy with it.
Roberto De Vicenzo hit a tee shot here in 11 that was almost unreal. He must have hit it 50 yards offline to the right, but he hit it so far that he cleared all the trees in trouble. He's right, almost green high to the right, better than 300 yards off the tee, hitting a sand wedge.
throws around the green. That could be a beautiful shot. That is a beautiful shot. Roberto De Vicenzo, who, believe you me, hits some sand wedge pitch to this green has marked his ball. He's no more than 3 feet from the hole. And Tony Lema has a long, long putt of maybe 45 feet or so. Hit it hard against the grain and stroked a pretty good approach putt from that distance. Put it perhaps, swap Gene, two and a half feet, something like that.
Well, he's got about 2.5, 3 footer. He'd like to have it closer because this fellow's putting for a birdie.
That's right.
You know, in a case like this, they don't mind dropping the stroke, but they don't like that two strokes.
No, it's true. Roberto needs this one to go back 2-1 under par. And he can't. Tony Lema will take a little time with this one. Made it a little bit left hand side, but she went in. Roberto, how you like this tree, Jim?
Did you know that there was fairway over there?
Well, I know. I practiced here before.
300-yard drive, huh?
A little bit more, I think.
How?
Roberto, did you actually mean to hit it that far to the right? We aiming.
Well, I try hit a high and long ball, and I think I catch this time. I tried to make three here because the other way I'd be dead.
Well, you hit that ball, according to everybody's guesses, about 325 or 30 yards.
Maybe.
That's a big shot.
Yeah. I think I'd be lucky after lunch.
But you had a three.
After good breakfast this morning.
Yeah. Well, Roberto picks up his three now, and you slip back to 1 under par, and you're only behind by 2 strokes after 11 holes.
Well, I hope you won.
Good luck to you. Both players parred the 169-yard 12th hole, so no change in the match. On the 388-yard par 4 13th, De Vicenzo hit the green in the regulation 2 strokes, but his opponent was unable to follow suit. Tony Lema, who has missed this 13th green, has left himself a 7-iron chip shot of about, maybe 50 feet, and thus far in the match, he has chipped and putted superbly. Hit it stiff again, Gene. About 2 feet.
He had that one figured out pretty well.
Well, as you've so often said, when you play a lot of tournaments and you play different courses every week, you just get that touch and that feel around the game.
That's right.
Tony's marked, and Roberto here with a possible chance to pick up another stroke. He trails by 2. Putt of perhaps 13 or 14 feet. Gene, we are really seeing some exhibition of chipping and putting. The crowd loved that one. Roberto ran it right in the heart to go back to 2 under par. Tony Lema cans his short one for a par 4, but at 300 now, he only leads by 1 stroke.
On the 14th, the 307-yard par 4 dogleg to the left, a charged-up De Vicenzo continued with the honor. His drive soared upward against the gray-green mountains and the deep blue sky of Greece. It bounced over a huge bunker and, scattering a knot of spectators, came to rest on a grassy knoll just short and to the right of the green. With such a big tee shot to follow, perhaps Lema began to press a bit. In any event, he caught the ball right on the heel of a club face, and it faded farther and farther and farther to the right, until it came to a stop less than 15 feet from an out-of-bounds fence. Fortunately for Tony, he had finished in newly solid rough, clearly labeled ground under repair, and was entitled to relief without penalty. So he dropped his ball outside the ground under repair, no nearer the hole, where he would still be lying 1. The distance remaining to the green was no more than 65 yards.
Lima's pitching wedge carried the pin and left him a downhill putt. Technically, Roberto also was on ground under repair and was entitled relief, but his lie was so good and his view of the pin so excellent that he chose to play the ball just as it lay. And his sand wedge pulled up just past the pin.
George, here's a putt that he'd like to hole.
Well, Gene, he has a downhill putt with what will be a pretty big left-to-right break of about 20 feet.
Yeah, it's a very big left-to-right account of the grain.
That's two putts that I can remember, Gene, that he had figured just dead center and just did not quite get to the hole.
Thought he had that one.
Well, Tony makes his four, which continues him at three under par, which is certainly very good scoring. But now Roberto, who hit a great little second shot here, has a downhill seven-footer that looks quite straight to square the match. He has, to this point, birdied two of the last three holes. And he has now birdied three of the last four holes, and we are all squared up with both players three under par.
Yeah, four threes in a row, huh?
How you like that three, Jim?
Huh? Gene just pointed out you've made four straight threes now.
George, see the way I play golf. I'm looking like I play JoJo. Bogey, birdie, bogey, birdie.
Well, you're making those birdies where they count right now, and you're making a great rush at Tony. You got a brand new match started.
Well, I go try to keep it in birdies.
Yeah. We'll see what happens from here on in. Tony Lima's putting frustrations were just beginning to build, as witnessed this try for a two from 55 feet on the very next hole. Two pars at the 15th, no change in the match. On the 16th, with De Vicenzo just inside him in two, Lima tried for a three, this time from slightly more than 20 feet. Boy, I'll tell you, Gene, he has gotten some real miserable breaks around that hole today.
Yeah, that was a beautiful putt.
Didn't look like there's any way that that putt could stay out.
Tony, I thought you had that one.
Oh, it wasn't even close, Gene.
I tell you, you have been around the hole so much, you got to start to talk to yourself a little bit after a while.
I've already started that, and I'm starting to give myself some answers.
I believe it. You almost pulled off. Let's see how Roberto does. Won't get there.
He was fighting the grain all the way.
Yeah, you could just see that ball bounce and jump. Left himself about a three-footer. One way to hit this, and that's firm, huh?
Good and hard.
And he did.
Right in the heart.
Real dogfight, 16 holes, both players 300 par, and the match still all tied on Shell's Wonderful World of Golf.
History is the reflection of the forces that shape it. And a vital living force in the long and glorious history of Greece is the sea. The men of Greece have always been men of the sea. And today, descendants of the Athenian sailors who carried the riches of their civilization to the limits of the known world still draw their livelihood, their sustenance, their inspiration from the sea. To visit the beautiful islands of the Aegean is to sail backward in time. Here people live much as their fathers lived, in tiny villages perched precariously on the harbor cliffs. Villages where the only streets are steps cut into the living rock. Theirs is a simple life, seemingly untouched by such visitors from the modern world as tourists who stay for a short while, bargain for a few souvenirs and then move on, or an artist who tries vainly to capture the beauty of their island with a brush. They mend their nets in a way old as time, dry them in the breeze of a thousand years, and build their fishing boats in the same style and manner as their fathers before them. Theirs is a good life, a rewarding life, and it is lived in the midst of unsurpassed beauty. But another more dynamic expression of the proud seafaring tradition of Greece exists here too. In large modern shipyards, the men of Greece build the mighty ships that will carry the commerce of today's world to the limits of all the seas. Here you will find tankers that carry the emblem of the world's largest commercial fleets, being refurbished, rebuilt, refined to fit the ever-expanding needs of the petroleum industry. Thus, Shell plays an important role in the economy of modern Greece. But even more important is the role of supplier of the vital petroleum products that modern industry needs to thrive and grow. In Greece, and in your hometown, Shell fulfills this role. For Shell is a worldwide group of companies dedicated to excellence, to the continuing search for new products, new ideas, new ways to serve you better. The 17th hole at the Glyfada Golf Club in Athens, Greece, is a par 4 of 417 yards, which doglegs to the left. A bunker 165 yards out on the same side is of little concern to the good player, since it is close enough to the tee to be carried with ease. On this hole, De Vicenzo hooked badly and disappeared into the trees on the left. His opponent drove to the opposite side of the fairway. Tony Lima faded his drive here on 17 about 255 yards into the right extremity of the fairway. He's behind a knoll. Has a completely blind shot. He cannot see the pin. He can only see the left-hand side of the green. He's going to take a six-iron and try to hit it up over those trees, and he also has a bunker to carry right in his line. And he got to well up over the trees, hit it a little bit left, and just did get on the front left edge of the green, right by the five there. Roberto De Vicenzo has really put himself in jail. He hooked his drive into trees on the left, 270 yards. There's a tree dead in his line. He's lying on hard ground. Must try to take a four iron and cut the ball around low and knock it somewhere near the green. He got it out, got it into the air.
And he got it on the green.
Where Tony Lima had to hit a very good shot to get the ball on the 17th green, Roberto had to hit almost a miraculous shot to get it on, and he did. But he left himself 55 feet from the hole with a downhill putt. Gene, that is against the green, right?
Yes, this is apt to fool him, you know. It looks like it's fast down there, but it's very slow as putting against the mountain. No, he hit it. Boy.
Look out.
He hit that ball. Look at
it. It's short. You can see it bounce all the way up, and he still couldn't get it to the hole. About 4 feet. And boy, is that ever going to be a nerve wracker.
At this stage of the game, that's about 10 feet.
I'm not kidding.
It all depends on Lehman now. If he can lay this ball absolutely dead, that'll make that putt pretty tough.
We'll just have to wait and see what happens. Tony Lima now from 45 feet.
And that's a beautiful putt.
Well, Gene, he has been threatening to do that. He had that one coming.
Yeah, he was due for one.
Holy mackerel.
They were all in cold storage.
They're all in cold storage. I just said to Gene that you were due for that when you really had it coming.
Boy, that thing was just dead on line, and I was just hoping it wouldn't run out of gas.
Hmm. This is an important putt right here.
That's right. It sure is.
Well, Tony, that moves you four under.
I feel pretty good, George.
Yeah.
About that. I don't make very many of those.
Who does? He made it.
He's putting too good, isn't he?
Yes, he is, but it looks like you got to take a one-stroke lead to the 18th hole.
Roberto.
That was a beautiful four after being under the trees.
How you lie, this my friend putt.
Well, he was due for one.
I putt like Roberto.
Oh, you fantastic, Tony. I know why everybody calls champagne, Tony, you know?
Well, one hole to go. Tony Lima, four under par. Roberto De Vicenzo, three under par as we go to the 18th hole on Shell's wonderful world of golf.
The home hole at Glyfada is a rather short par 5 dogleg to the left of 482 yards, playing down the usual narrow corridor of pines. The green is difficult to hole with a long second, however, as it must be struck high enough and long enough to carry a deep swale just short of the elevated putting surface.
Well, I have been around golf much of my life, and I don't believe I've ever seen a narrower driving hole than this hole. Here's Tony Lima one stroke ahead, Roberto De Vicenzo one stroke behind, a fairway the width of a bowling alley. And Tony has hit the ball a little bit left to right. Hits in the fairway and may go through the fairway to the edge of the rough. Pretty close one way or the other. Might be worthy of note to hear that Tony Lima hit the small ball also on this 18th hole. Now, De Vicenzo, who, if he can hit his typical right-to-left tee shot here, will be in great shape.
Oh, what a drive. That is perfect. That is perfect. Right-to-left, right down in the fairway. Tony Lima's tee shot here on the home hole, 275 yards down the right side in light rough and in a bad lie. He is not lying well at all, rather tight. He debated between a 2-iron and a 3-iron for a considerable length of time and is now going to hit a 2. He has hit a low screamer, which hits on the green. And he could not hold the green, I don't believe. Yes, he just went to the back left edge. Roberto De Vicenzo, a big tee shot here on the home hole. Very close to 300 yards, right side of the fairway. And he has but a 6-iron remaining with his opponent on the green in 2. He's hit it high. Pitches on the green and holds the green. Stand here on the 18th green at Glyfada, I can assure you this match is not over. Both players have reached the green on the par 5 hole in 2. Roberto De Vicenzo, 35 feet away with a downhill sidehill putt. Tony Lima, about 27 feet away with a very sharp downhill putt.
George, this fellow's apt to hold this. I have a funny feeling he's going to go for it.
Well, he has absolutely nothing to lose, Gene, trailing by one stroke. And if he could ever make an eagle here, he obviously could have everything to gain.
Did he get it? Did he hit it?
No.
No, left it short and to the right. And Roberto will have that putt to finish 4 under par, 68.
A little bit on the left-hand side, but he gets it in for a birdie at the 18th, and he finishes with 68.
Now, Tony Lima has 2 putts here for 5 under par on the 67.
And it's not an easy putt to lay dead at this stage of the game.
I wouldn't think so, Gene.
Because you sort of get over-anxious.
$7,000 to the winner here, $3,000 to the loser.
Left it a little bit better than 2 feet short.
So Tony has that putt to repeat now for a 5 under par 67 and a one stroke victory.
And he makes it.
Thank you, George.
We'll all get in on this act.
Yeah, we'll
I'm sorry. You played wonderful golf. And I want to congratulate you. That was a great performance. And you, I want to congratulate you for your great round of golf. It was great. And on behalf of the Shell Oil Company, we want to thank both of you.
Well, thank you, Gene. I always feel it's a real pleasure to play with one of my dearest Latin friends, Roberto De Vicenzo. I think he's one of the greatest in the world, and it's just a pleasure to play golf with him. And I'd also like to thank Shell for the three wonderful trips they've given me so far.
Well, Tony, yeah, you all the time you beat me. Uh-huh. Huh? But I wait time. For you next year. Huh?
Okay.
Yeah, maybe we can do something about that, too, because yeah. That all happened with about a 40 or 50-foot putt on the 17th. That was a change. We have both played great golf, certainly one of the most thrilling matches that we've ever been privileged to see, and thanks very much. Now, Gene, I imagine everybody's about set for this week's tip on technique, huh?
If you two fellows will just follow me now, we'll just
show them a little technique. After
congratulations again to you. What a match.
Well, two great fellows and two great golfers, and we'd certainly be very remiss if we didn't extend our sincere thanks to Hector Thompson, the head professional here at Glyfada, for having acted as our referee. We got a great kick out of being here, sir.
Thank you, sir.
And everybody in Greece has made us feel very welcome, and we hope to get a chance to get back here real soon. Thanks again,
thank
Hector.
Thank you very much.
Righto. And now, let's join Gene for a tip on technique.
For years, golf professionals have urged their pupils to hit against a firm left side, since letting the left side collapse is one of the major causes of hooking. Here's Tony Lema to show you the benefits of a firm left side and how to acquire one.
You're right, Gene. For many years, the collapsing of the left side has caused a lot of big hooks and swipes. And by the collapsing of the left side, we mean this. Both legs breaking in like this. If you come in with an open face, you'll hit a big slice. If you come in with a shut face, it'll cause a big hook. In order to ensure making a proper swing to get that hit against a good firm left side, as we start back, this left knee breaks in toward the ball, and the right leg straightens up to take all the weight that we shifted back. Now, as we start down to hit against our left side, we just reverse the procedure. The right knee will break in toward the ball, and the left leg will straighten up to absorb all the shock and the force, like this. That's what's called our firm left side. Let me show you.
Work hard on firming up that left side and watch that ducking hook disappear.